Grade A in our Coping with Chemo Peripheral Neuropathy program, our three panel members will speak, and then members of the audience will have an opportunity to ask questions. You will be given directions by the operator once the presentations are completed about how to ask your questions. Today our speakers include a gynecological oncologist, a pharmacist, and an oncology nurse with extensive experience in peripheral neuropathy. First, Dr. Dawson. Dr. Lisa Dawson is a gynecologic oncologist at the H. Bliss Murphy Center, St. John's, Newfoundland. She's also a member of the board of Ovarian Cancer Canada. Our next speaker, we're actually going to start with Kathy Fitzgerald, who's an RN and patient care coordinator at the H. Bliss Murphy Center, St. John's, Newfoundland. Kathy is a member of the Ovarian Cancer Canada board as well. Kathy will speak first, followed by Dr. Dawson, and then we'll have Dr. Carlo De Angelis, who's a doctor of pharmacy and the clinical pharmacy coordinator at the Odette Cancer Center in Toronto and also teaches at the University of Toronto. Kathy will wind up the call after that with some nursing components, and I think I will let the speakers take it away. Kathy?
Thank you, Elizabeth, and welcome, everyone. I'm going to start off a little bit about talking about what peripheral neuropathy is and sort of what occurs normally, and then how chemotherapy changes the peripheral nervous system to result in the peripheral neuropathy that so many women suffer from as a result of the chemotherapy. Peripheral neuropathy is defined as any injury or inflammation or degeneration of the peripheral nerve fibers, and you get a loss of both the motor and sensory fiber function that occurs as a result of the damage to the system. There's an interference with the signal that runs between the central nervous system and the peripheral nerves in the body. And the nervous system is responsible for pain, temperature. You get motor functions such as being able to distinguish objects that are placed in your hand, those kinds of things, your sense of balance, all that's affected if you have a peripheral neuropathy. So what happens is you have damage to the different parts of the nerve, which are known as the axon and the myelin sheath, which you may read about when you're looking at this sort of thing. And it's not really clearly understood exactly what happens to cause peripheral neuropathy. We believe that there is damage to the myelin sheath or to the cell body or to the axon or a combination of all those things. And what happens is the toxins from the chemotherapy get delivered along to nerve endings, causing damage and death, which may be temporary or could be permanent. So the degree of the neuropathy really is dependent on how severe the damage is. The literature tells us that about 10 to 20% of all individuals with cancer will experience peripheral neuropathy. And for those receiving chemotherapy, it's reported anywhere between 20 and 90%, depending on what you read, is the incidence of peripheral neuropathy. I think in our practice we see probably close on 70 to 80% of women who have some degree of peripheral neuropathy. Some is more severe than others, but certainly some degree in all of them. So I'll pass it over to Dr. Dawson.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for inviting me. I have to say thank you as well for this chance to sit down and think about something that I hadn't really reviewed the research on in quite a long time. So I learned a lot as I went through this process. I'd like to start just by telling you what my general counseling of patients is typically or has been typically regarding peripheral neuropathy and how we've always been managing it. I'm then going to tell you real briefly about what I've learned as I've done some more research and probably just a quick outline on where I think the future may hold, what the future may show. Up until now in my practice, typically I've always believed that peripheral neuropathy was a necessary evil of Taxol and platinum chemotherapy for women with ovarian cancer. We've seen that there's, as Kathy's mentioned, a huge range in variation in how bad women find this symptom. I've had many ladies who've had lots of cycles of platinum-based chemotherapy and really had very little difficulty. And we've had others who only after a few cycles have had significant problems with their balance or their ability to do their regular daily living activities like buttoning up their clothes. Or in particular, I remember one lady who used to play the piano quite well who was no longer able to do that. So I think the first key thing for patients that are listening now and for family members is that you share with your doctor how bad your individual symptoms are. Because we know that these symptoms sometimes are not reversible and they don't necessarily completely go away after chemotherapy, it's really important that if those symptoms are bad, that we stop the drug or decrease the dose as soon as we know that they're bad. If I remember one lady in particular who had terrible balance problems, and you know, I'm quite sure that if we hadn't stopped her drug when we did, that she would have run into a lot of difficulty with her independence in her life. So that, I think, is my main key message. In terms of what I've typically done, in the past we used to use vitamin B6 and give people vitamin B6 prescriptions with the hope that would somehow diminish some of the symptoms. I must say, as I've reviewed the research, I haven't really seen that there's a lot of proof behind that. We do find that some women come in and report that it feels a little better. That may be the case, but I'm not able to give a good scientific explanation for that. The other thing we sometimes do is tailor to women who have particularly discomfort regarding their peripheral neuropathy. And some ladies will find that they have a lot of burning and pain and tingling in their feet especially, and that may bother them a lot at night. We see those kinds of symptoms not just with peripheral neuropathy from chemotherapy, but also from other kinds of peripheral neuropathy for many different other medical reasons. In that regard, there is a fair bit of research showing that some medications in very low doses that are in fact antidepressants, which turn down the volume on nerves, can help with that burning and paining. If they don't work as an antidepressant in this scenario, they just help to take the burning and pain away from the nerves at night and help the person sleep. A good example of a drug in that category would be something called amitriptyline. And some ladies listening may have, in fact, tried that. So that's one important part of it, is distinguishing those people that have discomfort that interferes with their sleep. So typically, what I've just described is what I do in my practice. I've always sort of felt that this is something we couldn't avoid and that there wasn't really much research to help us. In fact, as I've done my reading now, I find that there's quite a lot more research than I had expected. In particular, for people that are especially interested in this, or people that have a medical background or who find that they can navigate medical things quite well, there is an excellent, although lengthy, review in something called the Cochrane Review, or the Cochrane Database. And this is a group that does reviews of all kinds of research on different topics and comes up with a real good summary. And so that, for people that are very keen or who would like to navigate medical things, would be something I'd look at for you. Anyone who wants the reference, I can give you that. It's published in 2007. When they looked at that, they looked at five different drugs. Those are amifostine, glutathione, something called DTTC, another drug called ORG2766, and the final drug was vitamin E, which we all know about. To keep it short, their conclusions on those five drugs is that none of them really are showing a proven, repeated benefit in different studies. And they have anywhere between 1 and 5 studies for each drug. As I've gone through them all, certainly the first four I would not recommend in my patients at this point. I don't think there's enough evidence to support it, and what's more, some of them do have side effects. I will say, though, that even though the authors of this review didn't recommend vitamin E, as I've looked at it, I think that there is some promise there. We do know that vitamin E has very little side effects, relatively speaking. And I think that as more studies are done, we might be beginning to see a trend there that some women might find a little bit of protection if they take vitamin E while they're getting their chemo. Now, I have to say right off the bat that this is not proven, but that it would be my opinion that it might be worth a try. I'll be keen to see what our pharmacist online might want to give me on that point. So my summary then, I think, to conclude, is going to be, number one, please share with your doctor how bad your symptoms are. If you're finding that your balance is bad, if you're finding that you can't do your regular things, like type, like do your buttons, if you're having any trouble with driving, in particular, if you're having any sense that your balance is bad enough to put you at risk for falls, it's really important to tell your caregivers how bad it is. We can sometimes modify your dose or change your drug to make a difference. And the second thing is really just to keep tuned to the research and keep asking about what might be new to help with prevention. Because as we know, things change all the time, and the next great thing might be right around the corner.